Our next speaker is Dr. Tennerson, who is a senior consultant in vitreo retina and uvea services from the Eye Foundation Group of Hospitals, a daring surgeon, very prolific, and he's going to talk on pachychoroid neovasculopathy case. On to you, Tennerson.
My sincere thanks to ARC and Chitra ma'am for giving me this wonderful opportunity. So good evening, everyone. So I'm going to talk about the case of
Tennerson, the signal is not good. Maybe you switch off your video and talk. Sometimes that might help.
Yeah. Am I audible now?
Yes.
Yeah. So a 62-year-old male diabetic and hypertensive patient presented with gradual progressive defective vision in both eyes. And his visual acuity is 6/60 and N36 in the right eye and 624 and N24 in the left eye. He had a significant posterior subcapsular cataract and his fundus examination, the media was hazy, and he had a mild non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy. He was routinely planned for bilateral cataract surgery. He was planned for laser refractive cataract surgery with trifocal IOL. The preoperative OCT was done in both eyes and there was a subretinal fluid in the left eye. So this was done on the day of surgery as the patient underwent go ahead with the right eye cataract surgery. Postoperatively, we had a good visual acuity recovery in the right eye. And subsequently, during the follow-up, he underwent fundus fluorescein angiography in the left eye. And telephobia and laser was attempted for that lesion, and one month later he was reviewed, and subsequently the fluid was persistent in the left eye, and since patient insisted and then he was explained about the condition, and then during the follow-up he needed the intervention and treatment for the left eye, he went ahead with the left eye cataract surgery. Post-operatively he had a improvement in the vision, and then subsequently, fundus fluorescein angiography was repeated, and again there was a same leak was there temporarily, along with there is a few microaneurysm leaks suggestive of mild non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy. This time we have done the focal laser to the lesion along with intravitreal ranibizumab injection was given, and during the follow-up at the end of 1 month he had a good visual acuity recovery, and this is the OCT picture which shows there is a very minimal residual subretinal fluid in the left eye, and he's on continuous follow-up. So he was diagnosed to have a pachychoroid neovasculopathy with choroidal neovascular membrane, and he had a combined treatment of laser and intravitreal anti-VEGF injection. So what is pachychoroid spectrum? So it has all these components. So specifically, pachychoroid neovasculopathy, it has a usually a double layer sign because of the CNVM, and usually we can differentiate from neovascular AMD by the absence of soft drusen and the reduced fundus tessellation. So usually we'll have a response, the pachychoroidopathy responds well to anti-VEGF injection, and if there is associated CNV complex, if it is foveal or juxtafoveal, PDT will be helpful, and if it is lesion is away from the fovea, focal laser will be helpful. But compared to neovascular AMD, it might require less number of injections. So my question to the panel would be how to approach in such cases, and how to advise for anti-segment surgeon to go ahead with the type of IOLs, because this patient was very persistent in getting a trifocal IOL to be done in spite of explaining him that he might have a near vision difficulty and he might require a recurrence and later on the follow-up. So thank you.
Thank you, Tennerson, for a nice delivery. And could we have Dr. Hemant Murthy discussing this case?
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Tennerson. A nice illustrative case. But one thing that I would like you to know is that, you know, the diagnosis of this, to make a diagnosis of pachychoroid neovasculopathy, you need to see the double layer sign. And an OCTA should show neovascular complex, which is, I think, then the diagnostic features of pachychoroid neovasculopathy, which is what has been described in all the articles, because there was a little of lack of understanding on what we should label as polypoidal choroidal, neovasculopathy. in that category, but in your patient, I couldn't see the double layer sign. I probably thought it was more of a CSR in character in this patient than a polypoidal choroidal, neovasculopathy. But I think what you have managed it very well. I think we all need to do an OCT. You asked me about what should be the preoperative workup. I think now most of us do a preoperative OCT before cataract surgery to detect all these subtle features, which sometimes get missed. I think you've done a good job in that and you're able to help. I would probably prefer a unifocal IOL because of the problems that these conditions induce. Yes.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you, Hemant sir. To just add on a few points to what Hemant sir said, Thinnerson, it's a nice case. So you asked about in which case these cases should we go in for the multifocal, trifocal, EDOF or anything. But if you look into the literature, most of the literature have shown that the patients with these kind, where they have early maculopathy changes or with relative sparing of the Snellen's chart, they usually have a low contrast sensitivity at lower spatial frequencies. Even with the milder form of these things, they have it. So it's a difficult counseling because now we have to see whether the clarity versus convenience, as we usually see in case of multifocality. But here, the contrast sensitivity at lower spatial frequency is present even in the milder forms of AMD, need not be a moderate or a severe form of AMD. So that becomes a kind of relative contraindication, but not an absolute contraindication. But however, if the patient had severe AMD, presence of Drusen, geographic atrophy, or any of these exudative changes, then that will be a definite contraindication for any of these multifocal lenses.
Again, the lack of contrast, which is also there partly with the multifocals, I think best to stay away from it when there's an added insult to it. Any other expert panel wants to add anything before we go on to our next speaker? Dr. Mallika?
No, I guess covered everything.
Okay.